Thank you, Herb. It's a great pleasure to be here. Last week was reading in the paper that Madison was voted once again as the best college town in the country. So it seems to be hot news around the town, and I can see why it is. I've never been to Madison. It's beautiful. I think the quaint Victorian houses and the college atmosphere is fantastic. Having grown up in a college town myself, even though I live in this giant metropolis of Los Angeles, I still am very nostalgic for that environment. So I really appreciated being here. And this year, it seems like we're kind of having the University of Wisconsin-UCLA exchange program, because Herb was out at our place giving grand rounds a few weeks ago. I'm here today. Herb's coming back out in a couple of weeks for another meeting at UCLA. And then I think our chair, Ron Bustill's coming to be a visiting professor this year. So it's fun to come and visit and learn about what's going on here. It seems like here you have a lot of great momentum, a lot of great new faculty that are doing great things. So I think it's a great time to be at the University of Wisconsin. So last night when we went to dinner, Dr. Weber and the group was saying, I'm really looking forward to hearing your talk because I think we're pretty pessimistic still at the University of Wisconsin. So I'm going to try to give you a little bit of state of the art, what's going on in the world of pancreatic cancer care, and talk about the direction forward for us. So it's true that this is a really horrible disease, that we actually see a small percentage of patients that actually have some survival benefit from the therapies that are currently available. But to be truthful about it, almost everybody dies within the year of diagnosis. If you look at the statistics, about 45,000 people in the U.S. diagnosed, almost the same number of people die each year. We have no real test to detect this early. To be honest, no true progressive chemotherapeutic regimen that's effective. Radiation is largely ineffective for this disease, and there's data out of Europe which suggests that it may actually be harmful. We have worked over the last 20 to 25 years in improving the surgical techniques, so we're sort of prepared, we're ready for patients to come to the operating room. We've made the operation safe, we've diminished the complication rates, the mortality rates have significantly diminished over the last 20 years. And so what we're really waiting is for the medical oncology side to get better with this disease, to have effective chemotherapeutics, to really move the disease in the direction that all other epithelial-based malignancies have moved in the U.S. and worldwide. And interestingly, although we're starting to dabble in the world of neoadjuvant treatment for this disease, there's never been a phase 3 trial conducted anywhere in the world to look at the utility of neoadjuvant treatment for pancreatic cancer. So we're about 15 to 20 years behind breast cancer, prostate cancer, colon cancer, gastric cancer, and there are a lot of reasons for that, but there's a lot of exciting momentum where I think we're going to catch up. Here's been the standard. Let's see, this has a pointer, yes, no? I can use the mouse, thank you. This has been the standard, gemcitabine. I just show you the survival curves. This is the study that came out in the late 1990s. Has been the standard for treatment for the last 15 years or so. 126 patients with pancreatic cancer randomized to gemcitabine of 5-FU. You can see the median improvement in survival was about 3 weeks. And so this was what we have been utilizing for the treatment for many years now. And we were all excited in 2007 when some targeted therapy came out. Tarceva, approved by the FDA for the use in patients with pancreatic cancer. This is the trial, gemcitabine plus Tarceva versus gemcitabine alone. And we got 6.3 months versus 5.9 months. This is about a $15,000 to $20,000 drug for an additional 2.5 weeks worth of survival. This is really approved based on studies with quality, improved quality of life. So this is where we are, the status that we are. It actually is a great field to be in because you can make small differences and seems to be make a big difference in the care of these patients. But I really think over the next 15 years, we're gonna have a true transformation in this disease. It's going to require a lot of education of physicians in the community for them to realize that this is not a death sentence. And I'll talk about the progress we've made now and then get into a little bit about the directions we might take to try to get to that point. So if you think about it, right now what we do is we see patients really are way out on the left-hand side of the curve here. We're seeing patients that basically have metastatic disease. 85 to 90% of patients have metastatic disease at the time of progression. And this curve you could apply to any cancer, really, any epithelial solid malignancy. And what we need to do is move this curve to the left so that we begin to see patients who have only local disease and not metastatic disease. And what we'd like to do eventually, as we begin to understand more about pancreatic carcinogenesis, is actually move the curve over here where we could actually do some preventive strategies for patients that are at high risk for the development of pancreatic cancer. So, as I said, this is not a paradigm that's specific to pancreatic cancer, and it's happened for breast and other solid malignancies, and I think it will happen over the next decade. We have made progress in the operating room, like I said. So in the mid-1990s, reports of five-year survivals and case series of patients undergoing resection for pancreatic cancer would quote a five-year survival rate between 12 and 17%. Not great numbers, but really there has been improvement in survival over the last 10 years. And we are seeing now reports of five-year survivals approaching 35% to 40%. Why is that? It's probably because we're selecting patients better because we have better imaging. It's because patients are more likely to be receipt of adjuvant treatment. And we are obviously getting them through the operation better than we were 25, 30 years ago. So a 35 to 40% five-year survival for resected patients is a reasonable number. It's a doubling in the number and the resection and the survival rates over the last 20 years. So this is an area of hope. We know that if we do the operation safely and we are meticulous and we try to limit the use of blood products intraoperatively or postoperatively, patients do better. This is a story that's been the case for a lot of other cancers too, probably due to the immunosuppressive effects of a blood transfusion, or possibly this is a surrogate for just very complex and advanced disease. But if we're careful in the operating room, we again get a reasonable pushing 40% five-year survival in patients who don't receive a blood transfusion or low blood loss, and this has been borne out by many case series. At our place, we use the top four things on this list to stage patients preoperatively to determine whether or not they are resectable candidates for the operating room, and this has been a big change. So in the mid-1990s, when I was training as a resident, we would get a CT scan, and it was really like looking at regular tube TV versus an HD TV that we have now. We have such better imaging that we're able to see smaller disease and able to stage the patients better and probably select them better. We often use EUS at our place to get a tissue diagnosis. This is something even 5 years ago we weren't doing. We use it frequently because we see patients at our center with a lot of unusual diagnoses. So somebody who has a lymphoma that happens to be located in the head of the pancreas shouldn't go to the operating room. So oftentimes we have a tissue diagnosis before we go to the operating room. And obviously have a reasonable tumor marker, CA19-9, to try to help us determine if the patient is resectable. There are lots of other imaging modalities that are available, PET CT, MRI, MRCP, ERCP, and laparoscopy. I see you did a laparoscopy on your patient that got the neoadjuvant treatment. We generally don't use those modalities at our place. We're pretty happy with the imaging that we get out of a helical pancreatic protocol CT and don't find PET particularly useful because really only about 60 to 70% of adenocarcinomas of the pancreas light up on PET. So we haven't found that to be particularly, isn't part of our algorithm for preoperative staging and evaluation. And just to remind the group here this morning about how we stage patients with pancreatic adenocarcinoma, because it really wasn't until about 10 years ago that people reliably began reporting this in their case series. And in fact, even up to, say, 7 or 8 years ago, people would lump pancreatic cancer with ampullary cancer, with duodenal cancer, and call it periampullary cancer and report survivals on all of those different diseases. And we know now that ampullary cancer, there are different types of those, biliary and pancreatic ampullary cancers or intestinal types. And so people now are getting much better at qualifying their patients and staging them and reporting those numbers. And it helps to understand what the true survival and how to kind of zoom in on all the different areas and how patients present to try to appropriately manage them therapeutically. So a T1 tumor is a tumor that's less than 2 centimeters and limited to the pancreas, T2 greater than 2. If there's direct extension of the tumor outside of the pancreas into the duodenum or to another organ, then that's a T3. T4 would be direct extension into a large vessel, largely the SMA. N1 or N0 is obviously a plus or minus no disease, and then whether or not they have metastatic disease. And in our place, for a patient who comes to us for resection, a surgical evaluation, we would not routinely resect vessel. If the vessel is involved, we would routinely have them undergo a period of neoadjuvant treatment. And I'll talk about that in a second. And then if they still had vessel involvement, we might consider resecting them. So really it's patients with stage 1A through 2B that are acceptable candidates to go to the operating room before any treatment has been delivered. And so if the patient has extra pancreatic involvement, obviously we would not resect them. Patients who have disease in the liver, patients who have nodal disease outside of the regular nodal basin that we would resect in. So if we see a large celiac lymph node, sometimes at time of endoscopic ultrasound, the gastroenterologist will biopsy the celiac node. If that's positive for adenocarcinoma, we would not think that that patient is resectable because we would not be working on those in that nodal basin. Generally, we use the 50% cutoff with regards to the SMV or portal vein as far as how the involvement of the vein with tumor. If it's less than that, we think it's a pretty good chance that we can still resect them and that they don't actually have vein involvement maybe about 85% of the time. Obviously, if they have large vessel involvement, we don't take them to the operating room. And this is some data out of our place that was published in the late 1990s using a CT scan to try to stage a patient's vessel involvement. You can see this patient here that we would say has minimal SMV involvement. Here's the SMV, SMA, the aorta. Here's the lesion in the head of the pancreas, the duodenum sweeping around here, and you can see maybe about 25% of the circumference of the vein is involved here, where here's a larger tumor, a patient with a stent in the bile duct, maybe 50% of the circumference of the vein. Here's some larger area. Obviously, this is a patient who has involvement of the celiac artery, so we would not resect this patient. So patients who are kind of in this stage 1 or stage 2 area, we would consider taking to the operating room up front before treatment. We have lots of other great imaging, like I talked about. This is an interesting patient of mine that had, this is just a reconstruction of a MRCP, a patient who had an IPMN in the tail of the pancreas. Let's see if I can get that to come back. Out here, who was getting recurrent pancreatitis, and we did a distal pancreatectomy for this patient ended up having high-grade dysplasia, not an adenocarcinoma. So a lot of great tricks we can use and better imaging to help stage the patients. So pylorus preserving Whipple has really been our preference at UCLA for many years. Dr. Longmire, the founding chair of our department, and Bill Traverso were big advocates of this. And so we would generally do a pylorus preserving Whipple for patients who have head lesions, obviously distal pancreatectomy and splenectomy, and work out of our place by James Tomlinson, who's a surgical oncologist at our group and works with our pancreas group. He has found that we try to get at least 15 nodes to adequately stage the patients. It's not like we're picking additional nodes during the operation, but once we sort of made the decision that this was an adequate nodal report with 15 nodes, all of a sudden the pathologists started reporting a lot more nodes in their reports. So that I think is important, and we're able to adequately know whether or not the patient has positive nodes. So this is our reconstruction here. This would be a standard Whipple. We do, I'm going to show you some pictures here, but we do a endocyte pancreatic jejunostomy, endocyte biliary anastomosis, and then downstream duodenal jejunostomy that's anticholic from and downstream from the biliary anastomosis. This is just a picture looking towards the patient's head here. Here's the head of the pancreas. This is the SMV, the sweep of the duodenum coming around. This obviously nice, thin patient from the West Coast. This looks pretty. I chose pictures that were nice for the presentation today. But here's the neck of the pancreas, SMV, portal vein, common hepatic duct. Here's the duodenum and the head of the pancreas. The patients who have soft pancreases, we oftentimes put these stay sutures in the neck of the pancreas to try to give it a little bit more substance so that when we come across the gland, there's a little bit less bleeding, and when we make our anastomosis, that holds the suture a little bit better. This is looking from the left to the right, the portal vein SMV cut edge of the pancreas here, and we're taking the attachments of the uncinate off the SMA and SMV. And this is the specimen out. So here's the retroperitoneal dissection, SMV, the hepatic artery here. And then our anastomosis to the pancreas, we do a two-layered anastomosis. It's somewhat of an evaginating anastomosis. The stent is there just so that we can find the duct. We don't leave a stent in, but we do an inner layer of running. It's almost like a bowel anastomosis, an inner layer of running 3-OPDS. And a couple of the sutures on the back and the front row incorporate the pancreatic duct. And then the outer layer is with just interrupted 3L silk suture, sort of evaginating that into the jejunum there. And then the biliary, and this is what that looks like when it's set. So we've made a lot of progress in the world of surgery. We can do it safely. We know how to maybe better stage people preoperatively, and we have known over the past decade that it's important that volume makes a difference. These patients should be taken care of by people who do them frequently at facilities that do a lot of them. We have a pretty big center, and I don't think that this is necessarily due to the specific surgeon's technique, but more for me, it's the group think that happens when you're at a place where there are a lot of people who come to work every day and think about patients with pancreatic disease. You bounce ideas off, the complications that come after surgery, the radiologists and the gastroenterologists have then developed expertise to help you with that. But this is data out from Berkmeyer. Obviously, everyone's very familiar with this, but the data would suggest that not only is it the volume that the surgeon does, but also the volume at the facility itself. And of course, now everyone's as excited in the world of the pancreas about doing minimally invasive approaches to pancreatic resections, laparoscopic pancreatectomies, robotic-assisted, there's a lot of discussion happening. At our place, we do most of our distals laparoscopically. We're more likely to do that for a neuroendocrine tumor or a cystic lesion. A large bulky adenocarcinoma we would not do laparoscopically. We've not done any Whipples laparoscopically or robotically at UCLA. We'd love to. I'm trying to find the time in my schedule to learn how to do that. I think that what has happened over the last 20 years is we've prepared ourselves in the operating room for hopefully what I think is going to be an increased volume of patients. We know how to do it safely, and we can deliver a great value for that. At our place, we have a big group, 15 faculty who are involved in medical oncology, pathology, radiology. We meet once a week before our clinic on Thursday, discuss cases that are coming in, and between all the groups have a fairly large volume and do between 120 and 150 resections a year, and pretty good survival for patients with adenocarcinoma. We have a nice tissue bank, and a group of basic scientists who are focused on the DC, so it's a great, exciting place to be in if you're focused on pancreatic cancer. One thing that we could really do in the world of surgery that we haven't done a very good job of is to educate community physicians that it makes a difference if you can get your pancreas removed, your pancreatic head cancer removed. This is data that was published in 2007 looking at how patients are cared for in the U.S. And this is a graph showing patients who have stage 1 disease, so patients with resectable tumors less than 2 centimeters, no evidence of any distant disease, no evidence of any vascular involvement. And amazingly, only about half the patients in the U.S. are ever referred for resection. So if today we made a decision and told everyone that if you have a stage one patient with pancreatic adenocarcinoma, we could today make a very big difference for a portion of the patients who have pancreatic cancer. And so we as surgeons need to get that message out there. I think that people that are in community practice who maybe have been in practice for 20 or 30 years remember when a patient went to the operating room and had a Whipple and had the horrible complications at their place where they were training, maybe even died. That's not the case anymore. We need to get the message out there that we can do it safely. This is data that shows that it makes a difference. So here's a patient from this series who had a stage 1 disease and got surgery. If you have stage 1 disease and don't have surgery, your survival is the same as if you had stage 3 or stage 4 disease. So it makes a difference to go to the operating room for these patients with early disease. So it's still a bad disease. Number 4 cause of cancer-related deaths in the U.S., and number 2 cause of GI cancers in the U.S. We'll have about 3,700 new cases of pancreatic cancer in the state of California. We have 35 million people in the state, so there's a large volume of cases in the state. But interesting, California is a little bit different than the rest of the country. I think that there has been this big consolidation of the care of pancreatic cancer in centers, like here in Madison. But that's not what has happened in the state of California. So if you look to see where the pancreatic resections are done in the state, over half of the resections are done at hospitals where there are only 1 or 2 done each year. So we have some work to do on that in the state. It's not really clear why that has happened. It's a big state. There are a lot of people. That probably explains part of it. But also we have something called the Kaiser system. And so there are a lot of Kaiser hospitals that do 1 or 2 of these types of cases each year. That may partially explain it, but we have not had the consolidation like has occurred in the rest of the country. So the patients who are resectable are rare, like I said, maybe 15% of the time. Most patients have metastatic disease when they present or have locally advanced disease involvement of the vessels and so are not candidates to go to the operating room. And still, if you look at the data, the median survival is pretty poor if you look at all large series and kind of group that together. And so we have a lot of progress to make. So how are we going to get there? Well, it's, as I said, a very exciting time to be in the world of care of patients with pancreatic cancer because there's a tremendous amount of new focus and energy, mostly coming from basic scientists in the country. And probably occurred because of the formation of a couple of foundations in the country that began to do advocacy work in the late 1990s for this disease. So if you think about how diseases in this country are funded for research, good or bad, a lot of it has to do if there's an advocate. So if there's a Lance Armstrong or somebody, a Katie Couric, who's going to Capitol Hill, has very high profile and lobbies for this, that's actually a large part of it. You know, there are runs with pink ribbons for different diseases and things like that. It's just the way that funding works in the U.S. So this year, the NIH will fund about $85 million in pancreatic cancer research. Breast is $500 million, prostate's about that too. So for the number 4 cause of cancer-related death in the U.S., so it's been grossly underfunded. That's much better than it was 10 years ago. But there is now high-quality scientists working in the field, and we're beginning to really learn a lot about the biology of this disease. And that's what's going to drive new understanding of how to treat the disease, hopefully drive people to focus on early detection, ultimately get to improved chemotherapeutics and improved imaging, and in the end, be in a place where we can begin to prevent this disease. So I think Dr. Weber and I, are friends who do pancreatic cancer surgery, are going to have a lot more volume coming forward because there's going to be a big change. So it's amazing to think about the fact that it was not till 10 years ago that we actually knew what part of the pancreas where pancreatic cancer originated. We didn't know if it came from Asner cells. We didn't know if it came from the islets. There was a group in the country that thought that there was a transformation of islet cells that ultimately developed into adenocarcinoma. We didn't know if it came from the ductal epithelium. And so it really wasn't until the early 2000s that people began to coalesce around the concept, almost like there is in the colon of kind of a polyposis to cancer type syndrome. And the idea of having progressive dysplasia in the pancreatic duct took hold. There was solid evidence to support this. And this was largely coming out of Baltimore with Ralph Rubin and his group, where you have a progressive series of events that occur, something called pancreatic intraepithelial neoplasia, or PANN. 10 years ago, this wasn't even reported in pathology specimens as to whether or not the patient had a PANN lesions or not. And so you have this early dysplasia, PANN1 lesions that are sort of low cuboidal changes in the ductal epithelium, all the way to very dysplastic lesions in PANN3, which in essence is high-grade dysplasia, and then the progression to adenocarcinoma. We had no idea what the genetic alterations were with this, and in the last 10 years, there's been a lot of progress. So a lot of focus right now on the role of KRAS, oncogenic KRAS, and early on, it appears to be actually protective and drive senescence in the pancreatic ductal epithelium. And now we know that with other events, other genetic mutations or environmental events, that's what we think probably drives the formation to pancreatic adenocarcinoma. So we've only known that for 10 years. And if you think about the other diseases, it's been known that polyps were important for the progression of colon cancer for 25 or 30 years at least. So we're behind, but we're catching up. Lots of new data to describe what are the genetic changes. And now we have transgenic animal models to be able to study this in the laboratory. So we have animals that overexpress mutant KRAS in the pancreas. And these animals go on to make Pannon lesions, and a certain percentage of them go on to make adenocarcinoma. If you cross those with other, like a P53 mutation, the progression is much more rapid. So there's a lot of ability now in the laboratory to study not only how does pancreatic carcinogenesis occur, but also how we might be able to prevent that using those animal models. Oftentimes I get asked the question, how long have I had this cancer? Because to the patient, they've had it for 2 weeks. They got a scan, they got a biopsy, and they have metastatic disease. How long have I had this cancer? And in the world of the pancreas, we really didn't know how long it took. But some data over the last year and a half out of the rapid autopsy program at Baltimore suggests that really the early lesions, the early Pannon lesions, and the amount of time it takes to get from that to an adenocarcinoma is at least 10 years, and patients probably have had adenocarcinoma for quite some time before they even show up to the attention of a physician. So we know that there's a series of events that occur that potentially offer the opportunity to intervene before they convert to an adenocarcinoma. This is what I mean about serious scientists doing work in the field of pancreatic cancer. Not until 4 or 5 years ago did we ever see a publication in Nature or Science or PNAS or these really high-impact, very meaningful journals. We would never see that about pancreatic cancer. It was in surgical journals. It was maybe in gastroenterology. Now there are some heavy hitters in the world of cancer biology who are focusing all their research efforts on this problem. And so that's why I think we're really going to be able to make some great progress. We know that pancreatic cancer is complex. It's not just the ductal epithelium that's involved. And something that's particularly unique to the pancreas is that there's a large, dense stroma that makes actually treatment very difficult. So there's you don't see that in colon cancer, you don't see that in breast, you don't see that in gastric cancer. It is the activation of a population of cells called the stellate cells that produce this large desmoplastic reaction and make delivery of chemotherapeutics very challenging. And so there are people working on all aspects of this. The stellate cells in the pancreas weren't recognized till about 7 or 8 years ago. And so we'll make progress going forward. Our group has been really focused on the role of inflammation in pancreatic carcinogenesis and the role of our diet and how that might influence inflammation in the pancreas. And we just started a new program project grant this summer looking at the role of high-fat, high-caloric diets and pancreatic carcinogenesis, and have had some preliminary data in these transgenic animal models where if you feed the animals a high-fat diet, they obviously gain weight, and you give them a second hit inducing pancreatitis with cerulean, which is a CCK agonist and is the model in mice that we use to study acute pancreatitis, that there are many more advanced Pannon lesions in the animals that get the high-fat diet as compared to a control normal mouse diet. You can see here that there's a 25% instance of Pannon 3, or the high-grade dysplasia, versus the control diet animals, which have just a very small percentage of high-grade dysplasia. So the diet, at least in these animals, are driving the sequence from early Pannon lesions to high-grade dysplasia and ultimately adenocarcinoma. And this is some histology sort of showing that. This is the animals that receive the high-fat diet. You can see that there's a lot more of a desmoplastic response, a stromal laying down. And if we got a little bit closer up, you could see some of the high-grade Pannon 3 lesions. So the project is looking at utilizing these KRAS transgenic animals at the role of inflammation, autophagy, desmoplasia, and the specific aims are to look at the inflammatory processes that are driving this progression to adenocarcinoma, to look at the role of using anti-diabetic drugs, which I'm going to talk about in a minute, for the concept of chemo prevention to prevent the progression from Pannon 1 to adenocarcinoma, look at the role of autophagy, and then look at the role of alcohol abuse, because we know that patients who have chronic pancreatitis have an increased risk of developing pancreatic carcinoma. There are a lot of risk factors that that can lead to the development of pancreatic carcinoma. We now know that patients who have hereditary pancreatitis, those patients who have a defect in the trypsinogen gene or a defect in the inhibitor of trypsinogen, have a really high risk of pancreatitis. So this is actually cancer. This has actually moved into the clinical realm, and we've had the opportunity to take care of several families with hereditary pancreatitis. These patients are being followed serially with imaging, with either MR or with EOS, to look for early changes in the pancreas that might be suggestive that they're forming pancreatic cancer. And for some patients, we're actually doing prophylactic pancreatectomies. So a patient who has an early lesion, we think that they don't have cancer, or some other reason to be going to the operating room, maybe for pain or something like that, we would probably not do a drainage procedure on a patient with hereditary pancreatitis. We would just simply do a pancreatectomy because we know the chance of them forming pancreatic cancer is really high. So we're beginning to use these risk factors to stratify treatment, and I think that that's going to happen more and more. Obviously, other things like smoking and alcohol and environmental data suggests that these are important second hits in that pan and progression process. It's okay to drink coffee this morning. Coffee is not a risk factor. It's in the news often. It kind of goes back and forth, and whether it's protective or not. This week it's protective, so you're good. I think it's probably not a real risk factor for patients to develop pancreatic cancer. Diabetes is an interesting thing. I'll say that before I go on to this next part, and that is that diabetes is not necessarily a risk factor for the development of pancreatic cancer, but can be actually a prodrome to pancreatic cancer. So about 20% of patients who have a new diagnosis of pancreatic cancer will have had a new diagnosis of diabetes within the past year. And I've had one patient who had a really smart internist. The patient was 62 years old. He was thin, healthy, worked out, no family history of diabetes, got diabetes. The internist thought, this is very odd. Why does this patient have diabetes? And actually did some investigation, and the patient had a pancreatic adenocarcinoma. Diabetes is too frequent of a new diagnosis to be able to use that as a screening tool. as compared to the incidence of pancreatic cancer. But I try to tell medical students that are going to be going into internal medicine or family medicine to kind of remember that in the back of their head. There are occasions when early lesions can be picked up in that scenario. So the real trick to all of this is going to be a way to detect the disease earlier. We need a PSA. We need some sort of screening tool because most of the time patients show up with disease in their liver already. And there's a couple of investigators at our place, David Wong, who's actually a dentist, and James Farrell, who's a gastroenterologist with our group, who've been working in the field of early detection and use of biomarkers. And amazingly, they can use saliva to detect pancreatic cancer. So this work they've published looking using RNA array analysis of saliva from patients who are normal, who have chronic pancreatitis, who have pancreatic cancer, and they can discriminate using four genes, the expression of four genes, whether or not the patient has pancreatic cancer. Now, this is a small group. There were 60 normals and 30 patients with pancreatic adenocarcinoma. And the sensitivity and specificity is pretty high. So if you look at pancreatic cancer versus healthy controls, a sensitivity of 0.9 and a specificity of almost perfect. Certainly when they expand this and they do sort of a prospective collection of saliva at analysis, these numbers will change, but it's pretty compelling at this point. They can also discriminate between pancreatic cancer and chronic pancreatitis, which is difficult because sometimes patients with chronic pancreatitis will have KRAS mutations, and certainly can discriminate between cancer and patients who don't have pancreatic cancer. So the four genes that they've identified that are abnormally expressed in the saliva are KRAS, not mutant KRAS, but just KRAS, which is involved as a GTPase involved in cell signaling. This other MBD3L2 opposes methylation silencing, so that kind of makes sense. But again, it's being expressed in the saliva, so we haven't quite figured out why that is. Another sort of diffuse gene involved in sperm zona binding and ovum penetration, why that would be overexpressed in the saliva in patients with pancreatitis, it's hard to know. And then another cellular enzyme involved in sugar homeostasis in the endoplasmic reticulum. So now what they're doing is they're taking this data and now doing a more prospective and a large trial to try to define if this is actually going to bear fruit for with a larger group of patients. They've also looked at the salivary microbiome. So amazingly, patients with pancreatic cancer have a different microbiome and the saliva than patients who don't have pancreatic cancer. Why would that be? It's hard to know, but they found that if the patients have the certain Neisseria species and a strep species, that they get a 96% sensitivity and an 82% specificity at discriminating between patients with pancreatic cancer and patients who don't have the disease. So there are a lot of different ways to think about how we might screen for pancreatic cancer and using saliva or other biofluids to try to do that, looking at the proteome, the transcriptome, microRNA, or the bacteria or metabolome. Right now they're focused on RNA expression and the microbiome, and they're taking the data from these two projects and recruiting many more patients. They're going to recruit, their statisticians tell them they need about 4,500 to 5,000 patients. So, Dr. Weber, if you'd like to participate, we're starting that, and maybe we'll have a chance to talk about that. We need a lot of patients. Imaging is pretty great now. We have the ability to image the pancreas pretty well, get wonderful 3D reconstructions, coronal views that we didn't have before that I find really helpful in trying to plan the operation. This is a patient's thick slab image reconstruction showing the wall stent. Here's the common proper hepatic, the GDA, the proper hepatic. Here's the SMB. You can see a big tumor right here that encroaching on the vein. This patient has a locally advanced pancreatic cancer. So it allows us to make sure that the patient is resectable before we go to the operating room. But I think that imaging is going to even improve more, so that we'll know, maybe we won't need to do laparoscopy preoperatively before they start neoadjuvant treatment with imaging. If we had good imaging to be able to stage the patients and then be able to put them into the proper trials to try to figure out how to care for them. James Tomlinson, who's a surgical oncologist at our group, his lab is fully focused on the idea of improving imaging, and he has focused on using CA19-9, which is a sugar moiety that is shed into the bloodstream off of cancer cells, and that's how it's detected. Using diabodies that he's constructed in vitro, and trying to use PET in combination with these diabodies that target CA19-9 to try to properly stage patients, get better discrimination for patients who have metastatic disease. I'm sure that it's the experience here that oftentimes we'll get a CT scan and the radiologist will say, oh, there's a 1 centimeter something in the liver. We're not sure, hemangioma, cyst, could be tumor. Hopefully with techniques like this, we'll be able to have better ability to stage patients preoperatively. And the other possibility with this type of technology is to actually tag these diabodies with therapeutics. So he's working in that area too. But I think imaging is going to be much a big transformation for patients with pancreatic cancer. And we might actually be able to use imaging as a way to judge the ability of a patient to respond to therapy. We have a big group at UCLA that's focused on PET imaging and the use of that for diagnostics and theragnostics. And Tim Donahue, who's one of our young surgeons in our group, has been working with the nuclear medicine group to use PET imaging to predict response to gemcitabine. So I showed you that curve that gemcitabine is not particularly effective in this disease. But it happens that gemcitabine, there's a reason for that. Gemcitabine, you know, is a nucleotide. It plays with DNA repair, and it has to be transported into the cell. There has to be expression of the appropriate transporter into the cell, and it has to be metabolized to actually work. So if you begin to think about gemcitabine like you would any other targeted therapy, for that drug to work, there has to be the mechanism within the cancer cell to actually make the drug work. So they're working on in the paradigm of using non-invasive PET imaging to try to predict response to therapy for patients who are undergoing neoadjuvant treatment. What they have developed are a variety of probes that actually predict response to gemcitabine. So they've developed this FACT probe that looks very similar to gemcitabine, as metabolized by DCK, which is important for the metabolism of gemcitabine to ultimately be effective in the cell. And if a cancer cell does not express DCK, gemcitabine does not work. Interestingly, only about 10% of patients with pancreatic adenocarcinoma, their cancers, only about 10% of the cancers actually express DCK. So it kind of makes sense. I mean, what we did with that trial is we accumulated a bunch of patients, put them into a trial with a drug that may or may not work depending on whether or not the enzyme that activates the pathway is in place, and that's maybe why the survival advantage is not particularly robust. So this FAC is very similar to gemcitabine. It's transported by the HINT1 transporter in the cell membrane, and then is metabolized by the DCK. And if it is phosphorylated by DCK, then it lights up on a PET scan. And this is some work done in a mouse model where we actually took two cell lines, one that expressed DCK and another pancreatic cancer cell line that did not, and then imaged the tumors, and then did an experiment where the animals were treated with gemcitabine, and you can see control animals that did not express DCK, the tumors grew. The animals that had wild-type DCK and were treated, the tumors were much less robust, didn't go as much, and these were two groups of animals that didn't express DCK. So this is a way to potentially characterize the tumor in patients with pancreatic cancer before a decision is made to actually initiate gemcitabine treatment. This is a survival curve of two of a group of 48 patients who were resected looking at DCK levels in the resected specimens and then got treated with gemcitabine postoperatively. And the survival curve, so those patients who had high DCK, the enzyme expressed, had a really pretty amazing five-year survival, approaching just over 50%. And those who didn't have DCK expression had pretty poor survivals that were consistent with what we're used to in pancreatic adenocarcinoma. So using PET imaging not only to image and stage patients, but also to predict response to therapy is a potentially really transformative approach to the care of these patients. And gemcitabine may ultimately not be the best drug for this disease, but they're using this as a platform to begin to identify other PET probes that could be used for other drugs to help patients and to try to strategize and specifically target the actual enzyme or the marker in the pancreas which the chemotherapeutic will be most effective. This is some imaging from patients just to show that it works in patients. This is some imaging of patients with ovarian cancer, a patient who had pancreatic cancer. Here, a small, you can see this is lit up in the head of the pancreas, and another patient with ovarian cancer. So now this our group is recruiting patients into this where they have approval to study 30 patients. We've studied five so far, and we're studying these patients preoperatively. These are resectable patients that ultimately go on to receive adjuvant therapy after resection to try to see if this paradigm actually might work. So I think that like other epithelial-based malignancies, neoadjuvant treatment will become the standard of care for this patient population. What we're waiting for is actually effective chemotherapeutics. They will come as we understand more about the biology of the disease. But we had a chance to look back at what the current status is with regards to neoadjuvant therapy for patients with pancreatic cancer and looked at all the trials that have been conducted. Again, there's never been a phase three study done for patients undergoing neoadjuvant treatment, only phase two data. And we found 14 trials. Generally, these trials use gemcitabine and 5-FU or a combination of that. Two of the trials use radiation. And the idea was to look at, does neoadjuvant treatment help patients with resectable disease? So we do the image. It looks like they don't have involvement of the vein. There's no metastatic disease. We would normally be just taking this patient to the operating room. Should we be giving the patient treatment up front first and then go to the operating room? And then to look for patients who have borderline resectable tumors, patients that have involvement of the vessels, are they helped by neoadjuvant treatment? And if you look at this, the patients who were resectable up front, 65% plus of them were actually resectable at the time of surgery if they received neoadjuvant treatment. And upwards of a third of patients who were deemed unresectable before having neoadjuvant treatment ultimately became resectable in the operating room. So you can convert a fair number of locally advanced tumors, even with not so great drugs, 5-FU or Gemzar plus or minus radiation. So our conclusion from this was that we probably should not at this point with the current group of chemotherapeutics that we have be pushing patients with resectable disease into neoadjuvant therapy, but there clearly is data to suggest that this is advantageous for patients who have locally advanced disease. And if you look at the survivals, the median survival of patients who were resectable initially was 15 months, whereas patients who had borderline resectable, or median survival in the resected patients, 23 months who were resectable up front, and 22 months in patients who have borderline disease. So you can convert a patient who has borderline resectable disease to a patient who has survivals that's as equal to that of someone who presents with resectable disease. So the paradigm, the data is not great because it's all phase two data, not with great drugs, but the paradigm of doing neoadjuvant therapy is probably one that's going to take hold. And I know that it's happening in a lot of centers right now. So the definition of a borderline resectable tumor is abutment of the SMA, severe involvement of the SMB or portal vein, encasement of the GDA or certainly the hepatic artery, invasion of the transverse mesial is the current NCC criteria for borderline resectability. We have had the opportunity to do some downstaging at our place and have recently reported this data. This is data, patients that are highly, highly selected. And so I say that at the beginning, these are patients with good functional status who have locally advanced, no evidence of metastatic disease, who were actually taken to the operating room before they were pushed into neoadjuvant treatment and found to be unresectable at the time of surgery because there was involvement of the vessel and the surgeon thought that that was not the right course of action. So it wasn't just the imaging that showed that they were unresectable. And then they got neoadjuvant treatment. I mean, it was neoadjuvant after an exploration. And then went on to the operating room, and I'm going to show you the data with and what we did with these patients. So these patients got a multi-drug regimen, which is now, I think, coming more into popularity over the last year and a half for all patients with pancreatic cancer. But they received 5-FU, leucovorin, mitomycin C, and dipyrimidol. And the median length of treatment for these patients with this regimen was 8 to 9 months. Not the standard 12 weeks that is often done for neoadjuvant treatment. What we did was, is if we saw a response to treatment, we just simply continued to give the therapy, and the patient continued to have a response on scans. We just continued to give the therapy, and they tolerated it okay, and we watched the CA19-9 and did serial imaging to make a decision on when to go to the operating room. So, the patients who were re-explored, if it looked like the tumor pulled away from the vessels, there were some patients where it didn't look so much like the tumor pulled away by the vessels, but they had a dramatic decrease in their CA19-9, and they all had good functional status before they were re-explored. And this is an example. Here's a patient with a tumor in the head of the pancreas, involvement of the vein, and then we get it shrinking and pulling away from the vessel there. So what's the outcome? So 41 patients, 83% of them were then deemed resectable at the time of the second exploration. 7% were unresectable for a variety of reasons. And interestingly, like your patient that was presented today, Sharon, most of them had no negative disease. It's something that we don't really understand why this is happening. It happens the same way for neoadjuvant therapy for rectal cancer. Oftentimes the treatment clears the nodal basin. We don't know exactly if that has impact on the survival of the patient. But it's an interesting observation because it's a complete flip of what we normally see, where about 70% of patients with adenocarcinoma have positive lymph nodes at the time of resection without treatment before you go to the operating room. Here we go. And here are the survival. So the median survival of this highly selected, good biology group of patients is 52 months. And the follow-up is fairly long. So there are several patients that are still alive. We have 9 patients who are 5 years out without evidence of disease. So what does that mean? Should this drug regimen be used for all patients? Probably not. We don't know it's the right combination, but it's just the concept of delivering multi-drug therapy to patients preoperatively and maybe getting better results. Been a lot of work to try to improve upon gemcitabine with targeted treatments. None of the doublets that have been reported have been shown any benefit over what is normally given just with gemcitabine alone. But about a year and a half ago, there was a great and exciting report about the use of FOLFIRINOX, oxaliplatin, irinotecan, 5-FU, and folinic acid to try to improve survival with patients who have metastatic disease. So this study showed that there was an increased survival of 7 to 10 months of this multi-drug regimen as compared to GEMZAR. And you can see that that's a very exciting thing in the world of the pancreas because we were getting 2 or 3 week improvement in survivals when you use GEMZAR alone over 5-FU. So I think internationally people are now switching to a multi-drug regimen. It's difficult in these patients because sometimes the patients come pretty debilitated and they can't tolerate this. You can sort of dial down the dosages to try to make it more tolerable. But now folks are beginning to use this regimen for the use of neoadjuvant treatment for patients with locally advanced disease, kind of like the regimen that I talked about at our place. And this is what we're mostly using now for downstaging. So FOLFIRINOX is, I think, the new standard of care for metastatic stage 4 pancreatic cancer. The progression-free and overall survival was much improved, and we are, as I said, testing it in the adjuvant and neoadjuvant setting. We've had the opportunity to test a lot of other sort of targeted ways to get at the biology of pancreatic cancer. We spent a lot of time in the early 2000s targeting VEGF in a variety of different ways. And after sort of the negative results of this, there is initial response, at least in mice, to targeting VEGF. And the trial that came out with Avastin in patients with advanced pancreatic cancer showing no benefit over Gemzar alone, we sort of left this field of angiogenesis and didn't think that targeting a single angiogenic mediator was probably going to fix the problem. So I circle back to the issues of risk factors. So not only are they risk factors, they're potentially ways to prevent the development of the disease. And we have taken this tack using some of the transgenic animal models and trying to inhibit the progression of Panin lesions to adenocarcinoma, and have worked a lot, as I said, in the field of inflammation. We spent some time looking at COX-2 enzyme and its role in pancreatic carcinogenesis. And this is just some data from using the KRAS, PDX KRAS mice, treating them with a COX-2 inhibitor, nemolizumab, showing that it was a decrease in the number of advanced Panin lesions. If you kind of group them together here, Panin 3s, there were much fewer Panin lesions in the animals that were treated with the COX-2 inhibitor, and there was a shift towards earlier lesions treated with the COX-2 inhibitor. And so we think that there is the opportunity for patients who are characterized at high risk to try to prevent this process of formation of pancreatic cancer. So a lot of excitement in the world of cancer biology about metformin. Metformin is a drug that is used, obviously, to treat diabetes. There was an interesting epidemiologic study that came out in 2009 showing that patients who have diabetes and on metformin have a 60% lower incidence of pancreatic cancer than patients who have diabetes and are not on metformin. And if you're on metformin and you get a cancer, your survival is better than patients who are not on metformin and get cancer. So we're doing a lot of work now in the role of metformin as a preventative and actually as an adjunct to as a therapeutic. Metformin is important for mitochondrial function and also stimulates all the usual cascades, intracellular cascades, probably mostly works through mTOR. And we've done some work in animals using mTOR and using metformin to target as a therapeutic in an orthotopic model. This is some data showing that if we actually knock out the signaling cascade for metformin, that the cancer cells grow faster than those that where the signaling is not knocked out and the cells are treated with metformin. And in an animal study, that in a dose response way, we're able to inhibit the growth of human pancreatic cancers in mice. And this is reproducible with several cell lines. So we're now actually looking at the role of metformin as a preventative. Again, getting back to the idea that these patients who are on metformin have a lower incidence of pancreatic cancer. And it may not be that we're going to use metformin as a real drug to try to prevent it, but to understand that biology of what it is that's happening in the cell by metformin, how is metformin actually producing this effect of decreasing the progression of pancreatic carcinogenesis, and using that mouse model, the KRAS, mutant KRAS mouse model, to study that. So I conclude to say that pancreatic cancer still remains a very serious disease, but there are rays of hope. We have made surgery safe. We've made a lot of progress with regards to staging patients. And right now, the really transformative thing is that there are a lot of scientists in the country and internationally that are focused on the disease that are going to help us understand the biology and identify targets that will give us more effective chemotherapeutics. So I imagine by 2025 that it's possible that Dr. Weber would be operating on Panin 3 lesions much the same way that we do for DCIS in the breast. If we had proper imaging to identify Panin lesions, we knew that those were going to progress if the patient had a high risk for development of pancreatic cancer, and we could do prophylactic resections. That would be the ultimate goal, and it's possible, I think, because there's a lot of great things going on. Obviously, a big shift would happen if we could have some way to have early detection. So I think it's an exciting time to be in the field, and I really appreciate the opportunity to come and speak with you all today.